Hello everyone, this is RJ Palmer, and I'm here to discuss ancient Greek weaving and household textile productions with you today. So the purpose of this research is really two questions and some ideas on women's role in society. And what is the possible economic impact of small-scale textile production within the ancient Greek world? And following up on that, how long does it take to weave an ancient Greek textile, and how that relates to production and sale of textiles? These both are really meant to confirm prior research that women could have had a much larger economic role in the household, but this research is incomplete without experimental archaeology in recreating these textiles. So the parameters of this experiment. This experiment uses evidence from Italy, Greece, and Turkey. There are some archaeological finds that are in Italy that you can't find in Greece, and Turkey likewise. There are some tools from Italy that are essential to understanding the tools and how they were used with a loom. And there are some textile fragments in Turkey that are also essential to this research. Similarly, this focuses on the 6th, 5th, and 4th centuries BCE. Although this isn't exclusive, there are a few archaeological finds from the Bronze Age that are used, and there are some from later Iron Age that are also used because they are important. The wool for this experiment was store-bought, but the material width and colors were based on textile fragments from the period, and the calculations have been made for how to spin the wool and how much time that would take, as this is a very essential and time-consuming process in the textile production. The amount of weavers used to calculate how much could be produced is based off of some research by Dr. Linda Foxhall. And she estimates that a base crew of 3 weavers is needed to properly use a loom to maximum efficiency. This is also backed up through some archaeology where, the depictions of looms would normally have groups of women using them. And these, at the bare minimum, you need a second person to use certain functions, which we'll get to later on. Creating the loom. The loom used for this project is a single heddle warp-weighted loom created by the author. It is not necessarily the morphology of ancient looms, which is a difficult archaeological question to answer, to be honest, but it is functionally like these ancient looms. And I would say it looks a fair bit like some of the Greek depictions. The loom weights used are discoid loom weights, measuring about an average of 180 grams. These are pit fired, as many of the archaeological remaining looms are. And these are handmade, which a lot of these loom weights are. And the reason I didn't necessarily want to create exact copies is to replicate the experience of using these rather than an specific example. These loom weights are often different weights within the same set. And so I thought it was important to have those variations. And the looms and tools are used to create a type of textile called a chlamys, which is a fairly simple and common cloak worn by travelers. We'll get into both the tools and what the chlamys looks like in a second. So the tools, these are the main tools used in the experiment. Again, these are not necessarily the same morphology to ancient Greek tools, which is, there are very few examples of those to truly go into, full morphology, but they share many of the formal qualities that these tools require, and these have direct correlations to the literature on textile from the ancient Greek perspective. So left to right, there is a wooden weaving knife, iron shears, a bone needle, and a wooden shuttle. And these are all fairly essential tools to most textile production, but specifically warp-weighted textile production from the era. And here is a period depiction of the chlamys from about the mid 5th century BCE. It is the cloak that this man is wearing. This is a depiction of Hermes, who is often depicted wearing a chlamys. And as you know, his chlamys has a very thin stripe near the edge. If it's about to the knee on his right leg and about to the waist and just the very tip of his wrist on his left side. Yeah. These cloaks are fairly common especially when you're traveling or hunting, they're written about fairly often. So the experience of weaving itself, warp-weighted looms do require a different set of skills to successfully operate than modern or early modern looms do, which is where most of my experience is as the main weaver of this experiment. One of those skills is rolling up the warp, which is very different from modern looms, which, you know, use kind of tension and this system of just moving the tension bars. This requires you to untie the weights, which releases the tension there, and then roll up the warp on these two warp bars here. And then once it is rolled up and secured with knots on the sides, I think you could see them up there, then you need to reapply the tension by retying all the warp weights back to a good level. And normally doing a final, you know, check with the knots. This is a difficult process to initially, at some point you are going to have to pick up the weight of all of these warp weights and check it. Even if it's not on every single time you roll up, it is incredibly heavy. And that was one of the things that really proved that this needs to be done with a team. For this experiment, my father and I did it together, but I could not do it alone. These warp weights are real heavy, and so is the textile at a certain point. But this is essential to warp weighted loom production, and there's not necessarily a whole lot of literature about it, so I thought it would be important to discuss it for a second. And then here is the progression of the first chlamys. I made two, but mostly dealing with the first one. And so you can see that stripe near the beginning. It is not a perfect match for the other example that I gave, but it is fairly close. And then this is right after the first roll up. I had to change locations. So that is why you're seeing different walls, and a little bit of a different backdrop in the next set of photos. And this is the second, third, and then the final. Well, the second and third roll up, and then the final photo with the second stripe put in. I'll discuss this in just a second, but as you can see, the weights start coalescing in the center, and it creates a very, very loose outside edge. That is not necessarily how ancient Greek textiles would have been, but that is more of a result of user error by someone not terribly experienced with this type of loom. Although I don't necessarily consider that the fault, this loom is not a common everyday loom. This is my first experimental archaeology experiment with it. So this will most likely get better with time. But the results, as mentioned, it had a few flaws due to the inexperience of the weaver with this style of loom, but it is mostly within the dimensions planned. I took measurements of cloth on myself to replicate the chlamys that Hermes wore in that crater, and it measured out to roughly 70 inches by 30 inches. And this is about 30 inches on one side and 27 inches on the other side wide, and it is 72 inches long. So a little off, but not terribly. And overall, it took 66 hours. And as mentioned, I wove a second chlamys to back up these results, and that took about 59 hours. This is consistent mostly because that 7 hours was mostly used experimenting with, you know, exactly how do you roll up the loom, and oh, that didn't work, and you know, you have to go back and try different things. So I think that these results show consistency, and just it takes a long time to do this, and there's not much speeding up the process. And then here's a photo side-by-side comparison. I am left-handed, so it is worn on with the open side on my left side, opposite for Hermes, obviously. But as you can see, the comparison is mostly similar. It is a little bit short on the knee, but it does go to about the same part of my hand on that side, and it covers fairly well. So slight variations, which will happen, but these are fairly consistent. And then now that we know how long it takes to create such textile and some of the issues with it, we have to go to pricing these textiles. And so this is one of the difficult things about this research, because there's very little that is written about or recorded from the time period on textile prices and, you know, the market for these. A lot of that comes from the fact that this is primarily women's work or slaves' work, and that's just not as nearly as documented. The best indicators for the textile price are funerary laws that limit spending. Stella Spontadaki offered three or four different funerary laws, mostly all from the 5th century, but different islands. And I think the main one that I used for my research is a funerary law from Delphi, which limited the price of a blanket and a pillow at 35 drachma. And I used that as the main numbers for pricing, but this really means, you know, blankets and chlamyses aren't the same, but they are fairly similar dimension-wise. And so for this experiment, we are estimating that a chlamys is going to cost about as much as a blanket, which that $35 split a little unevenly, but mostly down the middle, the chlamys is worth roughly 20 drachma for the purposes of this. That is the closest research that I was able to find for pricing, which is unfortunate, and you know that is the reality of some of this research though. So combining everything together into a definitive number, with the data collected from the amount of time it takes to spin it and, you know, the amount of time it takes to weave it, it is estimated that the team of three women mentioned earlier could weave a chlamys within 3 or 4 weeks, or roughly 13 to 17 chlamydes a year. And because textiles are still mostly used for family production, most families are not going to sell most of these chlamydes. They're or whatever equivalent textiles they produce. They are going to wear them and use them as blankets and, you know, curtains and many of the things that textiles are used for. And so it is estimated that these families would sell less than half, or roughly 3 to 7 chlamydes or equivalent garments a year. And with the funerary pricing, this results in a theoretical profit of 60 to 140 drachmae. This is not going to be a definitive answer. The price of the drachmae and the price of textiles changes over centuries, and there's inflation, and you know, each island has its own worth of silver. But it proves the economic importance of textiles within household economics, and in a broader sense, proves the economic importance of women within ancient Greek society, which, you know, ancient Greek society does not have a very fond opinion of women, but I think it's important that we better understand and try to map out how their lives would have been. So, conclusion, this project is meant to better understand the possibilities of ancient textile production through experimental archaeology. Textiles had a much greater role in ancient Greek economics than what's recorded, and women had a much greater role in ancient Greek economics than what is recorded. But without physically recreating textiles, it's very much a shot in the dark on how much and how important these. So here's a list of sources. Thank you for listening to my presentation.